Hello there. Welcome back to the Rich Fritzky Show. I hope and trust that you all had a great week. Today's piece relates to two prior podcasts, the one about the whippoorwill and the wonder of my Aunt Dot. Crater Lake again, which lied in the Wallpack Valley atop the Blue Ridge in northwestern New Jersey. It wasn't far from the Delaware River or the Appalachian Trail. A first cabin sprung up as long ago as the time when the Roaring Twenties gave way to the Great Depression. More cabins would follow. But it is to the summer of 1966 I go, and the sounds of Simon and Garfunkel's Time It Was, and what a time it was. It was a time of innocence. Looking back, innocence and 66 were kindred spirits, for I may well have been as close as I ever got, or anyone can ever get, to living in the fold of the perfection of this beautiful planet that we torture with our sprawl, fossil fuels, greed, and indifference. Crater Lake's therapeutic, crystal-clear, spring-fed waters, Nan's Glockamora, our little red cabin on the water, the bathing rock, the great dock where we teenagers sought mightily to impress, and the blue raft in the center of the lake, where I'd often sleep at night in the fold of the Milky Way, all still lives so large in memory. There was softball and boat tag, a bit too much beer, our collective striving so hard to impress, showboating and battling in the water, hikes to Buttermilk Falls, Brinks Glen, and to lean-tos on the Appalachian Trail, the sneaking out in the dead of night and more. And yes, a bit of responsibility, the painting of Sam and Peg Reese's house, the building of their prodigious rock wall. I happened to love flipping the burgers and the dogs at our always huge weekend gatherings. The view from the incredible stone barbecue pit built by my dad cut through the trees to the water's edge. The blue of the water would shimmer as the sun rendered it a mirror that radiated brilliantly through the green leaves of the trees. There by that grill, I was one with both the living who I loved to my left and the saints and spirits I brushed up against in the wind, the wood, and the water that I embraced. About to go into my junior year at Seton Hall Prep, little did I realize then that this was to be the end of footloose and fancy-free summers, the harbinger of the very end of innocence. For the cares of the world, duty and responsibility were all about to come madly rushing in. The awful consequences of real life. In the immediate years to come, for instance, the United States, via eminent domain, was to begin stripping us of our homes at Crater Lake. And Vietnam, the United States Army, and the Marine Corps were to begin picking off my brothers and friends. And both I and millions grew more and more at odds with our government. The status quo was everywhere on trial. During my junior year, I would be introduced to working a real job and to the fact that we were a nation of haves and have-nots, where there were gross inequities and harsh injustices. I became immersed in civil unrest and big picture issues, and I grew increasingly politicized. This would lead to oh so many places in the years to come. But in the next summer of 67, to my witness to the 1967 Newark riots, and in 1968, to Bobby. My brother Frank, cousin Dave, and Phil Caffrey, three of our Crater Lake gang, would be off to fight in that most foolish of all possible wars, Vietnam, where Dave would lay his life down. My brother Bob would soon follow them in the demilitarized zone of North Korea and South Korea. The point? Our sweet summer sojourns were never going to be quite the same. Sure, I would go on continuing to enjoy this lake whenever life allowed, but never enough and never in so carefree a way. It forever remained a refuge, but no longer a playland. 66 was the end of our glory days. It also just happened to be the summer of the great forest fire that was to rage for 9 days and some. Community comes to mind first, for everyone on the mountain seemed to do their bit, whether it was making sandwiches or iced tea at the base camp or filling the 80-pound water tanks and slapping one of them on their backs to go face the fire. As I was 16, unemployed and of age, I literally got drafted into service. It turned out that Mr. Palladini, a friend, was the forest ranger, the commander who ran the show, and told me on day one that I'd be there for the duration of this fire. They were hitting it from the sky with tanker trucks where possible, and we, with our limited army that carried 80-pound water tanks on their backs. Miles a day were clocked just refilling those. We worked the periphery of this massive fire in a constant but so very often failed attempt to contain it. The most important lesson I learned on the first day was to never, ever trust that fire line. You may have just beaten back the fire on the fringe and secured a line, completely contained and out. Great, you'd lay down on the dry side of it to try to rest and sleep for just a bit, only to be jolted right back up by the sight of a wholly new fire burning on the safe or dry side of that line. The lesson? Forest fires travel. They burn through the roots in extremely dry conditions. There is a stark memory of being utterly foolish, of not falling back quickly enough, and of also suddenly being trapped one Friday night, quite literally surrounded by walls of fire on all sides. Both my friend Phil Caffrey and I, great fear but no panic, and yet had our shouting failed to draw the attention of the one who attracted the many who worked to clear a small gap for us to rush through, we would have been toast. I don't remember speaking about it at all that night, and nor do I remember speaking to Phil about it ever, not until recently, and only to verify the truth of it. I have another horrific memory of a man crying and begging Mr. Palladini not to give up on a line that we had been fighting to hold while strong winds were absolutely dictating otherwise. What was being given up was that poor man's house, a beautiful home on the far ridge west of the Appalachian Trail. Oh, the sadness and desperation in him. Never once did I change the clothes that grew black on the very first day. I did not sleep for more than half an hour at a time, and my diet consisted entirely of donuts, cheese, and bologna sandwiches, and the doctored iced tea that made you retch. Black from head to toe in the end, I couldn't help but be sadly elated because our crater lake, our homes, had been spared. I was one sweaty, sooty mess, and while I had grown accustomed, I must have smelled terribly. Almost catatonic, I remember stumbling down the half mile or so of dirt road and walking right into the lake, just far enough to drop down to my knees, where I simply fell forward and let the cool, blessed water envelop me. Face forward at first, I drifted off as soon as I turned to my side. And only with help, apparently, did I get to our shower, where I again fell asleep. And then finally, for what I was told was more than 14 hours. It took weeks to rid myself of the soot. One positive footnote of importance. In November of that year, a great surprise, I was shocked to receive a check for several hundred dollars from the United States Department of Interior with a letter of thanks for my service. I had no idea, but Mr. Palladini certainly did. Minimum wage, no overtime, but still, and 24 hours a day at what I think was a whopping $1.20 an hour. I used it all on Christmas, for Santa and I have always been tight. The gang who enriched my days that summer included my brothers, Frank and Bob, and cousins, Dave Cassidy, Maureen Burlington, Linda Evans, all of whom would grow to mean so much. As to others, Phil Caffrey, who later married Maureen, was born without a phony bone in his body and could not receive without giving. Ever the real deal, he was the kind who made you feel blessed to be in his company. Our friend Pat Patton was privileged and entitled, but wholly unaffected by it. Unique in this regard, he had a warm and welcoming soul. Lorraine Canary was boisterous, loud, funny. Again, like Phil, she led and punched with her sense of humor, but she was open, real, sensitive to the feelings of others. Kathy O'Sullivan was quiet, sweet, and shy, and always in the company of my brother Bob. There also was a guy I remember only as Hank from Wayne, a great guy. I recall spending an entire night just sitting on the hood of his car, listening to the Beach Boys, Simon and Garfunkel, and others. He loved the Beach Boys, God only knows, and Simon and Garfunkel's "Last Night I Had the Strangest Dream" about putting an end to war. And though she knew it not, Irene Harlan from Hicksville, Long Island, was the crush who made my heart skip a beat then, and with whom I enjoyed friendship and long conversations. But idiot that I was just too damn shy and afraid to take the chance. The music from our little red cabin never ceased. It was the summer of Camelot and Carousel, of the Kingston Trio and Peter, Paul, and Mary, of the Carpenters and Barber, of the Beatles. This tradition of blaring music into the soft silence of the forest would long be sustained. There was never again to be a summer like 66. As our band would see each other only infrequently in the next couple of years, and then no more, save for Phil and family, that is. It would be lifetimes later when I learned that Pat Patton had both suffered and died far too young. And while we had for so long been separated, it was amazing that it still struck the 16-year-old that lives in me hard. Pat and I had owned that summer of 66. We were the undefeated two-man softball team. Big deal, but a great memory. Every memory, beaming back, was rich, as there had never been a negative word or a disagreement, and there was that striking broad smile of his, smiling still. He wore it always, and I will look to see it again when all the mysteries unravel. He and some 150 plus more. And then so too Tommy Canary, and then so too my gentle brother Bob, who you met up close and personally as the star of my Don't Duck podcast. Sure, there would be many days at the lake to come, but that summer signaled the sea change. Never again would I enjoy such freedom. The world as it must took me, as it took you, as it takes all of us. The word is innocence, not freedom. Just innocence. I would have cried out, "Say it ain't so," had I only known that the damnable specter of responsibility was lurking, and would insist on piling on, and piling on, and piling on as year gave way to year. That's the exponential condition of life, the often unforgiving and mean-spiritedness of responsibility. And yet, it is only what we do with it that defines our story, our purpose, our ends, the essence and legacy of our having lived. Oh yes, time it was, and what a time it was. It was a time of innocence indeed. Thanks for being with. I'll look forward to having you with me the next time, I pray. Have a great week. Smile big. Take care.